Again, let me say good morning to you and bless you. And would you join with me as we open with a prayer this morning? Heavenly Father, we again come as humble as we know how. First of all, to thank you for your presence with us as we experience some dark days in not only the history of this nation, but for the history of this world. We pray now that you would just take care of us, lead, guide, and direct us. In thy name we pray. Amen.
As evening fell upon Jerusalem, in an upper room, Jesus gathered round the table with his friends to share one final supper and let them know that soon his time on earth was coming.
This morning would be a communion service at our church here on the first Sunday of each month. And of course, I would like to just say a little word about that. In doing so, I would like to refer to the 26th chapter of the Gospel according to Matthew, the 20th verse of that 26th chapter.
Now when the even had come, he sat down with the 12. And as they did eat, he said, "Verily I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me." And they were exceeding sorrowful, and began every one of them to say unto him, "Lord, is it I?" And he answered and said, "He that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. The Son of Man goeth as it is written of him, but woe unto the man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been good for that man if he had not been born."
This morning, I want to list, just try to say a little bit about this response that they made when Jesus said, "One of you are going to betray me." And they all said, "Lord, is it I? Lord, is it I?" The first thing that would attract our attention is that it seems to me that they should have known whether or not they were going to betray him, but they all asked the question. Now, this was a very high time in the celebration of the life of Israel. This was Passover celebration. And there are those who believe that there had been a previous meeting without the presence of Jesus. And of course, in that particular meeting with the disciples, the topic of discussion was who would be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Now, and when Jesus asked the question, that it is believed that some felt that he was really referring to their discussion. And of course, as you know, there were some who had some desire to be the greatest. Of course, they did not understand the kingdom and what the kingdom was all about. They were celebrating one of the high days in their life. They were celebrating the Passover Supper commemorated the time that God delivered them out of the hand of the Egyptian slavery after 400 years in slavery. And of course, after 400 years, you can imagine what it must have been like as far as their celebration was concerned. But along with that, I would hope that I would be able to go through this session without reflecting back on our own experiences as slavery was concerned. Most definitely was not 400 years, but it did such damage until even today, there are still some remnants of the effect that it has done on slavery. Because what slavery does for an individual, it not only enslaves their physical body, but it enslaves their mind. And there are those who believe that the slave here in the U.S. of A. has done more damage than any other action that has ever done. Until today, we are still suffering from the act of slavery. Not because of our physical hand and feet are in slavery, but it's because our minds, to a large degree, are in slavery. We see remnants that it seemed to be passing over, but all of a sudden, things happen to make us feel that we are back to where we started from. So this slavery business was a very, very difficult time for the Israelites, and God had delivered them out of that hand of slavery and has brought them not just into the wilderness, but brought them into a promised land. Now, you got to really capture that, because no longer are they in slavery. No longer are they on this 40-year journey to the promised land, but they are now living in the promised land. And not only that, the fulfillment of the prophet has come. The fulfillment of the Jesus who is now with them physically. But if you read a little bit earlier in that 26th chapter, you will find out that he has opened their minds and told them quickly that he would be killed prior to as soon as the celebration was over with. Now, on last week, I said a little bit about the event of really taking place on this very celebrated holiday or high days in their lives. Now, because the Passover, it was really one of the high days that went on for a whole week. But during that week, they were really strategizing on how to kill Jesus. And now one of the inside boys, one of Jesus' own disciples, has really given them a better path on how they can find Jesus, not so much as to what was his location, but they wanted to know his location when he was away from the crowd. They wanted to make sure that they did not cause an upstir of the crowd, because so many had become followers of Jesus. So now if they arrest him where the crowd were, then that would be an uproar. So one of Jesus' own disciples, Judas, had detected that Jesus was troubled in mind. And whenever he was troubled in mind, he would always end up going to his prayer ground. His prayer ground was located in the Garden of Gethsemane. So Judas is saying to these men whom really wanted to kill Jesus, I can almost tell you where he's heading to. See, because he is troubled. He is really puzzled. And when he leaves this supper, he is going to his prayer ground. And Jesus did. He instituted the Lord's Supper. I want to underline that, because occasionally I hear people say we are celebrating the Passover. We don't have no argument with those who have celebrates the Passover. But what we are saying, it was during the celebration of this Passover that Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper, where he took a piece of the bread that was used for the Passover Supper. He broke it, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, say, take this. This bread will represent my body that will be bruised for many. Likewise, he took the cup that consists of the wine. And I need to say that there are many debates as to what it was, but the Bible says it was wine. And that wine was used for the supper as a common thing in that day and time. And he took the cup that consists of the wine, and he told them to take it and drink it and do it in remembrance of him. As a result, he is really saying, you have the Passover date to remember the time that God delivered you out of slavery. And I say to you that we have a Passover date. It's referred to as the Lord's Supper, to be reminded of what he's done for us. And if I had to list the things he's done for us, we'd be here all night and we still wouldn't be touched the surface. But he's done so much for us. And I think this is a good time for us to really look back and think about what he has done for us and what he is doing for us. Even as we go through this virus that we are experiencing, where peoples are dying, our peoples are dying, the black man is dying at a much larger proportion. And then, of course, then we have this thing that happened in Minnesota that has really touched all of us to some degree. And, of course, the one thing I like to point out, and that is, it's not all black people doing demonstration. I will say one thing, the looting and the terror that is going on is not necessary. We need to do it peacefully, because it's been proven to us that if we do it peacefully, we can accomplish so much more. And I hope if any of us who are going to participate in any of the marching, we will make sure we do it in a peaceful-like manner, because we saw that during the civil rights struggle. And that is why Martin Luther King came so strongly on the scene, because his thing was peaceful marching, peaceful demonstration. And I'm saying to you today, that is the only way we're going to succeed is doing it peaceful and do it in a godly-like manner. I ask anyone that if you feel like you cannot go and demonstrate peaceful, you would do more service to stay out of the march, because you can cause more damage than good. So as a result, when we ask the question, when the disciples ask the question, Lord, is it I? Maybe some of us ought to ask the question, Lord, is it I? Am I doing that which is best for our people, for our nation, for this country of ours, and especially as a representative of God's children and one of the church members? And of course, I hope, and I say that with all sincerity, I hope. A little bit earlier, I asked someone the date of the second Sunday in July, and they told me it was going to be the 12th of July. And I'm going to say this, no meetings has been held, no decisions have been made, but the second Sunday in July, I want us to look at the possibility of coming back and going back in church, not just as we have been, but at some degree. That's a tentative date, the 12th of July, a tentative date. So if you want to spread the word that we're going back to church on 12th of July, please put the word maybe. We'll be going back to church the 12th of July. That is the second Sunday of July. It will also mark some 3 months since we've been in church. Some will say that we waited too long. I don't know whether we waited too long or even 12th of July or be too quick. I'm just simply saying that it's a target date that we can look at and maybe be able to go back in. And as a result, I just know God will be with us. And of course, if that date is not seemingly to be working out as we hope it would, then we will sit down and say our prayers and ask God to give us another date. Thank you. May God bless you. May heaven ever smile upon you. Give this a serious thought and ask the Lord, Lord, is it I? Have I done what I promised I was going to do as one of your children? Thank you so very much. You have a blessed day and enjoy it.
For receiving words of wisdom from Pastor Myers. Giving is a natural response for believers of Jesus Christ. We receive God's love and grace, and out of an overflow of a grateful heart, we give. We would like to encourage you to use our online giving feature on our website or to download the Givelify app to your phone. Search for O Macedonia Baptist Church in North Augusta, South Carolina. And don't forget to mark it as a favorite. To whom much is given, much is required. If you have problems or questions, please contact us using the contact form on the website at www.omacedoniabc.org. God bless. You have my mind. You have my soul.